Good morning, boys and girls. Today we are starting with our first menu for semester 5. So our menu for today is grilled fish with sauce maltese, sauteed exotic mushrooms, and jacket baked savory potatoes. So let's have a look at the division of ingredients and the plan of work. So for division of ingredients, we divided each ingredient as per the dish. So for the grilled fish, we have the white pomfret, which we're going to remove fillets of. For sauce maltese, we have eggs and butter along with oranges. For jacket baked savory potatoes, we have the baby potatoes with different kinds of fillings. For sauteed mushroom, we have button mushroom, oyster and shiitake mushrooms along with flavorings. And we have a variety of garnishes that you will see us using when we are doing the plating. So let's start with our plan of work. We are going to start by occupying the gas ranges. So on one gas, I've kept the potatoes for boiling. On the other gas, I've kept butter for clarification. Next, we come to the table. On the table, we've got our fish. We are going to remove the fins of the fish, and we're going to try and remove the fillets of the fish. So in order to remove the fillet of the white pomfret, there's no need for descaling because it does not have any scales. We start off by removing the head of the fish, and we remove the gut or the internal organs of the fish. Alright, so I'm removing the head here, and at the same time I'm going to remove the gut of the fish. Now once we remove the gut of the fish, we need to wash the fish. Meanwhile, you can see the potatoes have started to boil. So it's time to reduce the flame. At the same time, the butter has come to a boil. So I'm going to turn off the flame. As you can see, for clarification, we just need to heat the butter. So once the butter started to bubble, we are going to keep the butter aside and come back to the fish. So we start by removing the fillet. In order to remove the fillet, we make a cut on the corner and then use along the fins, outer fins, we are going to make the cut on the fish, and then we use the tip of the knife, follow the bone, and we cut on top of the bone. So using the tip of the knife, keep scraping the bone. Okay, using the other hand, lift the flesh so that we don't damage any flesh. So lift the flesh, and using the tip of the knife, just scrape on top of the bone. In case we go under the bone, then you have to put the knife other way around and just pull out the flesh. Okay, make sure that you're on top of the bone initially. See, as you can see here, in case I go under the bone, because the bones are very fragile and the knife is quite sharp. Okay, so there's a tendency that we go under the bone. So make sure that you're on top of the bone. So you're removing the fillet from one side. So scrape the bones, lift the flesh. As you reach the other side of the fillet, you keep your knife or place your knife inside and just remove the piece of fillet from the fish. So as you can see, one side of the fillet is almost out. You're going to keep it aside and start working on the other side. Next, we start filleting the other side of the fish. So in order to remove the fillet, we start from the tail side. So initially we start from the head side. For the second side of the fish, we start from the tail side. Again, using the tip of the knife, scrape on top of the bone. Once you are on top of the bone, then in that case, you will lift the flesh and use the tip of the knife to scrape the bone. Okay, make sure there's no flesh wastage in the process. In case you go under the bone again, make sure that you start from the other side and make sure that you're on top of the bone. That way, no flesh is wasted, no bone comes along with the fillet. Alright, so you can turn the knife as per your convenience. Again, very important, lift the fillet, scrape the bones. The bones have to come out nice and clean. Once you've scraped the bone completely, then you'll place the knife inside and just cut the ends of the fillet from the fish. So that's how you have the carcass separate and you'll have the fillet separate. Now in first year, you've seen we divide this further into two other fillets. So that's what we're going to do. We're going to cut off the belly portion because the flesh is very stiff. Okay, so we cut off the belly portion. And we further divide the fillet into two pieces. In case in hotels, if you were serving, you could serve the entire fillet as a single portion. But in that case, you will have to remove the bones. Okay, there are around 13 to 15 bones that are on one of the fillets. So you can use a plucker to remove those bones. If not, you can just divide the fillets into two. And one side you can make sure that there's no bones. The other side will have the bones, so you can just cut off the bones. As you can see now here, I will drag the bones and then I will just cut off the flesh which has the bones. So very minimal wastage. Okay, so here we have the two fillets ready. One is slightly broader, the other one slightly thinner. It's up to you how you want to serve. For a portion, you will be serving at least two fillets. Okay, further I'm cutting the other side or the other fillet. I'm removing the belly portion. All right, just trim off the excess skin. Now generally when you're removing fillets, we remove the skin as well. Okay, but here we are going to use the skin, or we are going to leave the skin on. Okay, leaving the skin on gives a very nice texture. Okay, you can remove the skin and maybe you crisp up the skin and use it as a garnish as well. But here we are going to leave the skin on. Okay, so it gives a very nice color, it gives a very nice texture to the fish. Okay, it prevents it from getting overcooked as well. So here we have the four fillets from the white pomfret that we just cut. Okay, now next we are going to just wash the fillets. Okay, pat it dry and then add it to the marination. So let's look at the marination of the fish. For marination we have some lime. Okay, what I'm going to do is I'm going to cut out wedges. Okay, once I cut out the wedges, I can keep the wedges aside for garnishing. So this goes onto a plate of garnishing. And the remaining lime, that is one wedge, and the center portion of the lime will be squeezed, okay, in order to get the lime juice. To the lime juice, I'm going to add some salt and pepper. Okay, once I've added the salt and pepper, then I'm going to just lightly mix the marination. Okay, and then add the fish to the marination and let it sit inside the refrigerator for around 2 to 3 hours, depending on how long you are taking to cook. Okay, so our marination is getting ready. Once the fish is marinated, then it goes inside the refrigerator. So after marinating the fish, we come back to the gas range. As you can see, the potatoes have been cooking for a while. So we're going to turn off the potatoes and use the water that we used for boiling the potatoes to rehydrate the mushrooms. The oyster mushrooms and the shiitake mushrooms that we are using are the dried form of these mushrooms. So we need to rehydrate them before we can actually process. So you can use the same water which you used for boiling the potatoes. Of course, make sure that the potatoes are washed before they are put for boiling. Okay, use the same water for rehydrating the mushrooms. So just lightly mix it, make sure that the mushrooms are rehydrated. It will take around 10 to 15 minutes for the mushrooms to rehydrate, and then you can process them. Here the potatoes are boiled. Okay, just have a look, and we are going to process the potatoes further. Now that our gas range is free, we start by reducing the orange juice. Here we have used the packaged orange juice, but you can use fresh orange juice as well. For flavoring, we've used some cinnamon stick. Okay, so for the jacket baked potatoes, we are further processing. Now the potatoes have cooled down almost. So just cut off the side of the potato, make sure it stands properly. Okay, and then we are going to just cut off the top and use a Parisian scooper. I'm sure you've seen this equipment. Okay, so use the Parisian scooper to scoop out the potatoes. Okay, we're going to just scoop out the potatoes. Make sure the jacket is intact, and once we've scooped out the potatoes, then we're going to process the mashed potatoes. Okay, so same process to be followed. We are just cutting the head off so that the potatoes can stand easily. Then we're going to cut off the other side, and then using the Parisian scooper, we're going to just scoop out the potatoes, which can be mashed, mixed with the other kinds of fillings, and then added back into the potato. Okay, now since the potatoes are cooked well, you have to be really gentle when you're removing the scoops of potato. Otherwise, you'll end up tearing the skin. Okay, So as you can see here, same process to be followed with all the potatoes. Once the scooped out potatoes or the scoops of potatoes are removed, then you are going to add some salt and butter, okay, and then we're going to mash it. In order to mash it, you can use a fork. Here I'm using a spatula, okay. So use a fork, just lightly mash the potatoes, mix the potatoes well, okay. The butter will help it smoothen nicely, okay. So some salt and butter, mix the potatoes well, and then we're going to keep it aside, okay. Simultaneously, just check for the orange juice. It is reducing on a low flame. Okay, it should not be boiling. So let it simmer. So here, once the potatoes are slightly mashed, then we are going to add the filling. So we've got some chives here or garlic greens. Okay, so just finely chop the chives. Again, get them together and finely chop them. Once you've finely chopped them, then add it to the potatoes. What you can do is you can keep some chives aside for garnish. Okay, you can leave the whole chive for garnish, or you can chop them and keep it. Here, as you can see, my orange juice is reducing. Alright, so I've removed the cinnamon. I don't want to overpower the orange juice with the cinnamon. So as you can see here, the orange juice is getting a syrupy consistency. So it's time for me to reduce the flame, or maybe, you know, if it's getting too thick, turn off the flame. Okay, let it cool down, and then we start by, you know, making the sabayo for the Maltese sauce. Okay, so turn off the flame. Coming back to the potatoes, you have to be very vigilant when you're making a menu. You have to balance out between your table work and your gas work. So here the chives are processed. You will add the chives to the potatoes. Moving on to our next vegetable. Here we have some spring onions. Okay, we are going to use the spring onion greens. Okay, again, the quantity of potatoes are very small, so we don't need too much of spring onions. Okay, it is a combination of chives, spring onions and chili flakes and a lot of other ingredients. So very little spring onions. Again, finely chop the spring onions and add them to the mashed potato. Again, same, you can keep some spring onion aside for garnish. You can also, you know, make garnishes out of the spring onion. Once you're here, I'm going to show you a few garnishes that you can use. Alright, then we've got some processed cheese. Using the small side of the grater, I'm just grating the cheese. Okay, while grating the cheese, it's good to apply some oil on the grater so that the grated cheese is separated. In case you're going to heat the cheese, then there is no need to apply any oil onto the grater. Okay, so I'm going to keep some cheese aside for garnish. Rest all the cheese will go inside the potato mixture. Okay, once that is done, I'm going to add some more cheese. So I've got some Parmesan cheese powder which is available with me. Okay, so I'm going to add some Parmesan cheese powder, and it's time to mix all the ingredients. Okay, before that, I will just add some red chili flakes to add some spice. Okay, so I've already added some salt and butter initially. So it's time to mix all the ingredients together and make the filling. Okay, what we are going to do is we are going to mix the filling nicely and fill the filling in a piping bag so that we can pipe it out into the potatoes and it can go inside the oven for baking. So now that the potato mixture is ready, it's time to put them in a piping bag. The potato mixture has to be piped out in the potatoes evenly. Okay, so here you can see I'm completely filling up the potatoes. Due to the heat in the oven, it's going to expand, so don't overfill it. It should not come out. Alright, just perfectly fill to the top. So once the potatoes are filled, what we're going to do is we're going to apply some oil. So using a small brush, I'm going to apply oil to the outer surface. When it goes inside the oven, the jacket is going to crisp up a little. Okay, so apply a little oil on the jacket. So once you applied the oil, it's time to top up the potatoes. So we got some processed cheese. Okay, so just lightly place the processed cheese on top. The processed cheese after heating or going inside the oven is going to melt, okay, and give a very nice brown top for the potatoes. It makes it look very attractive. At the same time, we've got some Parmesan cheese, so I'm going to use the Parmesan cheese as well. Okay, just drizzle some Parmesan cheese on top. So after baking, it's going to, you know, dry up further, and when we eat the potato, it's going to give a very nice flavor. Furthermore, place the potatoes onto a lid or a pie dish. Top it up with some chili flakes and put it inside the oven for baking at 180 degrees Celsius, 0% humidity, for around 10 to 12 minutes. Next, we are going to work on the mushrooms. So we squeeze out the excess moisture from the mushrooms. That way it helps us in better sauteing. So squeeze out the excess moisture from the shiitake. Same has to be done with the oyster mushrooms. Collect it all together. Squeeze out the excess moisture and then keep it on the plate. Once we've squeezed out all the moisture from the rehydrated mushrooms, it's time to retain the pot liquor. Okay, so this is the mushroom pot liquor. What we are going to do is we're going to retain the pot liquor and use it when we are sauteing the mushrooms. Next is to cut the mushrooms. So what we're going to do is we're going to cut the button mushrooms into quarters. In case the mushrooms are too big, cut them into 1/6. In case they are too small, maybe cut them into half. Moving further, once you're done cutting the button mushrooms, we start working on the shiitake. Now, shiitake is quite meaty flavored, big in size. Alright, so we've cut the shiitake mushrooms into strips. Okay, we can cut them into wedges as well. It completely depends on the chef. Here we've cut the shiitake mushrooms into strips. So once we are done cutting the shiitake mushrooms, we work on the oyster mushrooms. As you can see here, the texture of these oyster mushrooms are quite frizzy. So you can cut them into a shape that, you know, matches the size of the other mushrooms. If they are small, you can leave it as it is. If they are slightly big, maybe cut them into triangles or just cut them into half. So once the oyster mushrooms are ready, transfer it back onto the plate. Moving further, we look at the plate. Now all the mushrooms are cut. We look at the flavorings. We've got some thyme and garlic. So it's time to remove the thyme leaves. Now what you can do is you can keep the thyme leaves as it is with the stem. You can saute it and remove the thyme stems towards the end, or you can remove the thyme leaves at the beginning and add it as a flavoring agent. So as you can see here, fresh thyme provides a very nice flavor to the mushrooms and it complements the mushrooms very well. Alright, so once the thyme has been removed, we will keep them aside. Similarly, work on the garlic. Put the garlic on the cutting board. Just crush the garlic. Once we've crushed the garlic, we're going to slice the garlic and then finally chop the garlic. Again, for this preparation where we've cut the mushrooms into bigger pieces, we can leave the garlic as well into bigger pieces, but we've chopped the garlic. So here is the plate of the sauteed mushrooms ready. We can leave them at the lower deck of our table. So our next step is to get the clarified butter ready for sauce maltaise. As you can see here, once the butter is cooled down, the milk solids are settled at the base. In the center, we have the clarified butter. And on top, you have the milk froth. Okay. So you need to get rid of the froth. We've kept the froth aside. We have the milk solids at the base, so we try to avoid the milk solids from coming into the clarified butter. And we use the center, the clarified butter, for the sauce maltaise, which is a derivative of hollandaise. Please be careful, make sure that no milk solids go into the clarified butter. So here, as you can see, our clarified butter separated, and that's the milk solids. You can use it for any other preparation. It becomes very salty, at the same time has a lot of moisture content. Okay, so clarified butter is out. We start by, you know, using the clarified butter for the hollandaise. So keep the clarified butter aside. So our next step is to work on the sabayo for the hollandaise sauce. So we have the orange reduction ready, to which I'm going to add the egg yolks. Okay, so separate the egg white and the egg yolk. Collect the egg white in a bowl, which can be used for any other preparation. And the egg yolk has to be added to the orange reduction. Again, since the orange reduction is cooled down completely, we can directly add it. Or we have to cool down the orange reduction and then add the egg yolks, otherwise the egg yolk starts to cook. So we are adding two egg yolks to the orange reduction. Once we've added the egg yolks to the reduction, we are going to just mix it, maybe using a spatula or a whisk. To this, we can add any kind of flavoring that we want. Like for the orange reduction, we've already added cinnamon. But in case you want to incorporate any other flavor, now is the time to add. So mix the egg yolk and the orange reduction well. To this, you can add some salt and pepper. What I'm going to do is, once the egg yolk is nicely mixed, then I'm going to add some water to it, which will help it thin down. Mind you, the water plays a very important role when you're preparing a sabayo. If you do not add any water, then the egg mixture or the sabayo mixture doesn't cook properly or evenly, and it tends to get curdled. So it's very important that you add water. And now it's time to keep the sabayo on flame, or cook the sabayo on flame. Okay, so I'm going to use a whisk. Okay, it's very important that you control the temperature or the cooking of the sabayo. Initially, the flame can be high, but at a later stage, you need to reduce the flame and control the flame. Okay, so as you can see here, while I'm moving my whisk, you can't see any whisk marks. But as the egg starts to cook, you will see the whisk marks. So that is when you have to be careful. You have to slowly increase the temperature. Initially, it is at room temperature, but slowly it will increase to 60, 65. And at 70, 75 degrees Celsius, you will see that the egg mixture starts to cook. So as you can see here, I've taken this off the flame and I'm continuing to whisk. Okay, so I will put it back on flame just to heat it up a little more. And once the sabayo is ready, I'm going to remove it off the flame and allow it to cool down. As you can see here, you can see whisk marks. The egg is started to cook. If I cook it any further, it will curdle, and then I will not get a good hollandaise sauce. So I'm just going to use a spatula to clean the sides, because the mixture that is touching the pan is nice and hot. Okay, so just mix it all through. So one last time, I'm going to keep it on flame, whisk it, make sure the sabayo is cooked well. Once that is done, turn off the flame and remove the sabayo mixture. Okay, once this mixture is ready, it's time to add the clarified butter. So you can add the clarified butter drop by drop. Okay, again, initially you have to make sure that you're adding the clarified butter drop by drop. Once it starts to get incorporated into the mixture, then you can add it in a thin stream. Again, the amount of clarified butter is dependent on the number of egg yolks. So for every egg yolk that you take, you can take up to 100 ml of clarified butter. Mind you, if the clarified butter is too much in the hollandaise, it will start to split, or rather you will see a lot of butter or clarified butter floating on top, and it will give you a very greasy appearance. Okay, so the quantity of clarified butter is very important in terms of making a hollandaise or a derivative. Okay, so after we've added around 5-6 spoons of clarified butter, it's time to just slightly clean the bowl. So once we've cleaned the bowl, again we will continue adding the clarified butter. Now, as you can see here, I'm adding the clarified butter in a thin stream. So continue adding the clarified butter till all the butter gets incorporated. So while our sauce maltese is getting ready, let's do a time check on where we are in the menu. So as you know, the fish has been marinating in the refrigerator. It's time to remove the fish and bring it to room temperature. At the same time, our jacket baked savory potatoes are in the oven roasting. So once they are done, we'll remove them. Our mushrooms have been cut and kept ready for sauteing, so we'll keep them aside. We've already kept them aside. And our sauce maltese is almost getting ready. As you can see, we are at the last stages where you're adding almost all the clarified butter. And once this is ready, we work on our garnishes. Okay, we have some leek crisps and some orange wedges and some tomato confit that we need to prepare. So as you can see here, our sauce maltese is ready. It's time to season the sauce. So I've added some salt. If you like some pepper, you can add some pepper at this stage, but I am avoiding pepper because I don't want any specks of black in the maltese sauce. And now it's time to strain the sauce. Straining the sauce will get rid of any egg solids that are left in the sauce. At the same time, it will make the sauce nice and smooth. So for straining purpose, use a damp piece of muslin cloth. Just keep the muslin cloth on the bowl and then transfer the sauce onto a bowl. As you can see here, I have kept the sauce a little thick. If you want, if you're directly serving or smudging it onto a plate, you can thin it down by adding some warm water. Okay, but I've kept it a little thick because I intend to put it in a piping bag and then pipe it out. Okay, so as you can see here, the sauce maltese is nice and thick and it's nice and smooth at the same time. So we are going to fill it in a piping bag and keep it aside. Next, we are working on our garnish. So this is for the leek crisps. Okay, so just open up the leek and then shred the leek into thin julienne. So once the leek has been shredded into thin julienne, okay, we are going to just apply some salt and keep it aside. Again, we've already shown you the video of garnishes, so you can refer to the video in case you have any doubts on how to make leek crisps. So as you can see here, I'm adding some salt to the leeks. I'm going to just lightly mix it all together and then keep it aside for around 10 to 15 minutes till the moisture starts to come out. Once the leeks have started to leave out some water, it's time to squeeze out the excess moisture. Okay, add some refined flour to it and then fry it in hot oil. So as you can see here, the oil is nice and hot. Okay, I'm using a spider strainer. Place the leeks and just dip it in oil and remove till the leeks become nice and crisp. So as you can see here, the leeks have become nice and crisp. They've got a very nice golden color. So we remove it onto a paper towel or a tissue. So next we are going to work on another garnish, which is orange segments. So here I am cutting the ends of the orange, following which I'm going to remove the sides of the orange, thereby exposing the orange. And then using the knife, I'm going to remove the segments of orange. So remove around 5 or 6 segments of orange, which can be used for garnishing during the plate presentation. So once our orange segments are out, place them on the plate of garnishes. So our next step would be to saute the exotic mushrooms. Now in order to saute the exotic mushrooms, we've taken a saute pan. Add olive oil to the saute pan and allow the olive oil to heat up. Once the olive oil is slightly hot is when we add the garlic and allow all the flavor from the garlic to infuse into the oil, thereby making the garlic nice and crisp and at the same time it gets a golden color. Once the garlic is slightly golden in color is when you're going to add the button mushrooms and the fresh thyme. The button mushrooms need to cook for around 5 to 7 minutes along with the flavoring agent, that is fresh thyme. Okay, once the button mushrooms have cooked for around 5 to 7 minutes is when you will add the rehydrated shiitake and oyster mushrooms. So continue cooking the mushrooms on a medium to high flame till the mushrooms are cooked. Once you've added the shiitake and the oyster mushrooms is when you're going to add the seasoning and nice and toss it. Okay, so as you can see here, I'm adding some salt. I'll be adding some black pepper powder. And once we've added the seasonings is when we're going to toss it. Now in order to deglaze the pan, I'm going to add some mushroom pot liquor. The mushroom pot liquor will make sure that all the mushrooms are cooked evenly. At the same time, the salt will be evenly distributed in the mushrooms. So after adding the pot liquor, just lightly toss the mushrooms. Make sure that the mushrooms are cooked and we are good to go. Next, we'll be working on the fish. We will have to remove the excess moisture from the fish. So keep it on a clean duster. Place the fish, and then using the other side of the dusters, just remove the excess moisture. It's very important that we get rid of the excess moisture, otherwise after placing them in refined flour, it tends to form into a batter, which we don't want. So lightly dust the fish using refined flour, pat it dry, make sure to get rid of the excess refined flour, and then keep it on the plate. So now our fillet of fish is ready for grilling. So we take a saute pan or a frying pan. You're going to add olive oil inside. To the olive oil, I'm going to add some butter, which will provide an additional flavoring. So once the butter is melted, you can add the garlic. Okay, just crushed garlic will provide a very nice flavor to the grilled fish. So add the garlic, let the oil and the butter infuse the flavor of garlic, and then we will add the fish inside. You will start off by placing the skin side first. Placing the skin side will give a very nice shine to the skin side of the fish. At the same time, the flesh will not be exposed to the heat immediately. So grill it on one side for around 2 to 3 minutes. Till it gets a nice golden color, and then slowly we will turn the fillet of fish. So here you can see we are turning the fillet of fish. Once we've turned the fillet of fish, we need to cook the fish for around 2 to 3 minutes on the other side. At this stage, what we can do is we can use a spoon and pour all the excess fat on top of the fish. That way the fish will cook faster. At the same time, the skin will become nice and crisp. So once the fish is cooked, turn off the flame and transfer the fish onto a clean plate. Next, we start with the plate presentation. So here I'm using a paper towel as a stencil. Okay, we have got some parsley dust, which I'm going to just sprinkle on the sides, thereby keeping some gap at the center for plating the food. And then we are going to place all the other elements of the menu. So we start off by placing the sauteed mushroom. Okay, on top of the plate, we are going to place the sauteed mushroom. Again, the quantity should be enough to serve one portion. So here we are placing the mushrooms. We are using the mushrooms to provide some height to the fish. So place the mushrooms and then place a fillet of fish. Once you've placed the fillet of fish, right next to the fillet of fish, we have the jacket baked savory potatoes. So place the potato and then next another helping of the sauteed mushroom. And then, as I said, the mushroom is being used to provide the fish some height. So pile up the mushrooms and then place the second fillet of fish. Once we've placed the fillet of fish, we are going to place another portion of the potato. So for one person or for one portion, you can see there are two pieces of fillet. At the same time, there are two potatoes and some mushrooms. So now it's time to place the garnishes that we've kept ready for plate presentation. So I'll start with the segment of orange. Again, the segment of orange gives a very nice color contrast. It gives a very nice brightness to the plate. So place it next to the fillet of fish. At the same time, we've got some confit cherry tomatoes. So place around 4 or 5 confit cherry tomatoes here and there. The confit cherry tomato complements the orange and the brown color of the fish and the potato. So place them at different ends. following which, to give it a green tinge, we've used some microgreens. I'm sure you've seen the video of how to grow microgreens. We are using some chia microgreens that we had grown last week. So again, place the microgreens at different ends. Use of microgreens provide a very nice crunch, at the same time a color contrast to the plate. So place them at different ends, following which I can see here I've placed some leek crisp and a lime wedge. Again, plate presentation is completely up to you. So next we are going to plate the Maltese sauce. So what we've done is we've filled the Maltese sauce in a piping bag and we're going to pipe it out. We are going to pipe out a few dots here and there on the plate. Mind you, the Maltese sauce is an accompaniment for the grilled fish. So make sure there is ample quantity that you serve along with the fish. So next, what we are going to do is we are going to just take out the zest of orange and we directly place it onto the fish. When we are eating the fish, the small specks of the zest will provide a very nice citric tinge to the fish. At the same time, when you present the plate to the customer, you'll have a very nice aroma of the fresh orange. At the same time, we've got some fresh mint leaves that we are going to put on top of the orange, again to give it a color contrast. So here is our final plate presentation with the grilled fish and its accompaniments. So here we've done another style of plating with the similar elements. Thank you so much. Hope you like the video.